Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Daily Volatility Fox Report for October 8th, 2019. We are TOSindicators.com, home of the Volatility Box. For today's trading activity, we followed our game plan that we laid out for ourselves along with our subscribers yesterday, in that we used a conservative Volatility Box on the indices based off of the events that were scheduled for today along with the bonds. And then crude is the one where we were just using our regular first hour test to see what happened, to see if we could try and justify using an aggressive Volatility Box. And so with the conservative Volatility Box today, we did get one entry in the NASDAQ, the Dow, and the S&P futures. And we did not get that entry in the Russell futures. And what's interesting is if you had sort of used the aggressive Volatility Box, maybe that fit your style a little bit better. You did have one winning trade before our entries here, which ended up working out. And so watching that might have been one of those emotional roller coasters for yourself where you decided to deviate from the plan. And if you did, that's where these trades bit you. But for us, like, we stayed consistent with our plan, so conservative. And this is why we yesterday created that phrase, when in doubt, use the conservative volatility box, because we saw this added burst of volatility on maybe like the events today were a catalyst, more news event related things. It's hard to pinpoint just one, but we saw that we did breach into our conservative volatility box, which is what we started to see. And that's why we, again, when in doubt, just use the conservative volatility box, which we'll talk about in tonight's game plan as well. Anyways, for the S&P futures, that one trade was a winner, along with the NASDAQ futures, and so both of these gave us just our T1s, so $400 and $325 on that first contract, with the second one stopping at a break-even. And on the Dow, we had one trade, but both of our contracts were losers, and this was one of those, again, immediate fills, and then almost immediate stop-out on the Dow, and so we'll talk about what happened there, and sort of just how to manage your emotions in a trade like that, where the Dow had stopped you out almost immediately, your orders still hadn't been filled for the S&P and the NASDAQ, and it was one of those things that you're just sitting there scratching your head, because you're out of one trade before you even get filled into, I believe, both of these, and that might change your perception on those trades, and it's important to, again, remember each market is its own thing. So three trades in total, winning rate of 66% since one of those three was a loser, and then a positive P&L today of positive 225 after accounting for the Dow loss. So again, nothing to write home about, but still a positive green day. Now let's try and figure out a game plan for tomorrow. So tomorrow is Wednesday, October 9th, and we have a few different events, so we'll talk about each one. The first is crude oil inventories, and so we've talked about this for all of our subscribers in our trade plan, but you look at the volatility that crude is representing from 4 a.m. Pacific onwards, and so that's a few hours before the crude market opens. You want to see if there's signs where we've blown through the aggressive volatility box, anything that tells you that, okay, you know what, we are experiencing a little bit more volatility, let's go ahead and use the conservative volatility box. So any sign of that will be my sign to switch on over for the conservative volatility box to play the inventories. Also, just be aware of the actual number that comes out compared to the estimate of 1.8 million, and just use some basic supply and demand, right? Like, do we have greater supply, which indicates that we would expect demand to start to subside, so the markets come down, or do we have greater demand than we have supply, or supply is decreasing, and then what does that tell you about what that might do to price action? And that might just give you a little bit more confidence in your fades, right? It's not the initial reaction, it's the fades and the longer term sort of positioning that you might be looking at. And so that's our game plan for crude. Start observing 4 a.m. Pacific onwards to see if we have signs, and that tells us whether we can play the inventories report aggressively or conservatively. Next, we also have Powell speaking once again, along with FOMC member George, and we also have meeting minutes at 11 Pacific. So these times are in Eastern. And so for both of these, again, just based off of today, based off of what we've been seeing, the conservative volatility box seems like the way to go. Last time, I believe, with the FOMC meeting minutes, we had our first opportunity where you could have played it, the initial move, really aggressively. And then we switched on over to our conservative volatility box. If that's something that's just a little too advanced for you, again, just stick with the conservative volatility box. It's the safer one, and it's the one I think that we might be employing tomorrow instead of trying to be a little bit cute and play this a bit more aggressively. Finally, once again, another reminder, we released our latest indicator as part of the How to Think Script tutorials yesterday, and this is an indicator that we've called Smarter Earnings, especially with earnings season around the corner. You can download it for free at tosindicators.com/indicators. indicator/smarterearnings. And while most services indicators out there around earnings let you trade the before and after, this indicator is for the actual day of earnings. And we have two different strategies here, a gap and go along with gap fills. We're going to continue to add more just as weeks go by and people start to tell us some more observations that they've noticed around earnings or the day of earnings. And that'll be something that we look in. But you can go ahead and download this indicator and start playing with it right away for free on our website. All right, now let's dive into charts. So we'll start with the S&P futures, and I also have the Trade Flash tab labeled here, as you can see, and we'll reference this for sort of the second opportunity. So as per our trade video yesterday, we were already on the conservative volatility box. It's something we had announced across the board. And so using the conservative volatility box, our first entry came as we had an opportunity to get short as price slammed into our volatility box entry lines. Our stop was outside of the volatility box. We gave it 6.5 points of room. And you'll notice this is a little bit narrower than our usual 7.5 given the actual hour that this trade took place in, along with the fact that we were on the conservative volatility box. We ended up hitting that first target, moved our second contract to break even, but we didn't get the follow through that we were looking for to our second target before we were stopped out. And so to us, this was just our T1, and our second contract was taken out at break even. Then, as the markets continued to proceed, so we saw that it was a good idea for our second contract to have been stopped at a break-even. And at this point, the upper volatility box is still plotting somewhere around here. And then we had this massive spike down. Our orders were already canceled since this is the 55 candle. But if you, say, didn't happen to have your orders canceled and you picked this trade up, you had a really nice, just you picked up the tail end of this wick. You had your amazing follow through almost right away, and this was across the board for your T1, and then you could have adjusted your second target. For us, this was not a filled entry. Our orders were already canceled, and so we didn't catch this wick. But this wick, again, further reinforced the fact that the conservative volatility box is holding for at least our first target. And so then we're continuing to look for our trades. And at this point, our MIM or our MOC flashes, where we first find out that we have an MOC to sell. And for those of you who have ever asked us about the MOC, you know, at least the free version in Trade Flash, this only posts if this number is significant. And this number was significant today. You don't have the story of how we may have switched on over from the buy side to the sell side. But really what we see is our MIM was to sell. And this is the data that I think all Thinkorswim users can see. And again, this last puke happened with 20 minutes left into the market. So not really an entry that we were looking for. Both the MOC being negative, along with the fact that you're now into the close of the market, what kind of follow through are you really going to see in the final 15 to 20 minutes? And that's usually when tricky things tend to happen. There's that saying, I think it's beginners open the market and pros close the market. And so this is really not a trade that we were looking for. And so that was the end of the day for us on the conservative volatility box. This was our one trade entry that's set up. And now if we just kind of keep going through the MIM, you'll see it grows, I believe. So from 125 to, as we keep going, as we keep going up to 150 right here. And then you should also see it continue to grow to now 700 come 1250. And I believe that was the last data point. Actually, you might have had one more. No, that was it. And so you saw that our sell side market on close data was continuing to increase. And so that, again, one of those reasons why it's just best to stay out of the market. All right, next, let's take a look at the NASDAQ futures. That was one that also gave us an entry. Once again, we were on the conservative volatility box, and this is where we had our entry to go short. Stop was outside of the volatility box, 20 points of room. That 20 points was hit. Did not see that fall through to our second contract or second contract's target, which is at the target line. And we were stopped out on our second contract for a break even in this candle right here. And then we see, once again, a good move. Had that last puke. If you happened to catch that end of hour entry, good for you. You saw once again that follow through. We did not. That was the rest of the day for us in the NASDAQ futures. Now, let's show you a chart of the Dow, which is a little bit different. So, same volatility box on the Dow. Our entry came as we were filled at actually the tip of this candle, as we already had our orders out there to short the volatility box. Our stop was outside of the volatility box. We gave it 50 points of room. And here is where we were taken out almost right away in that same candle. And this was one of those grand opening, grand closing trades, just stopped out. And this is where, if you saw this take place, I believe this stop out happened. You were actually stopped out before you were filled on the S&P and the Nasdaq, and so your emotions at that time might tell you, or just human gut, human instinct tells you that, oh shoot, don't get into this trade. The Dow is already giving you sort of the heads up that you're getting stopped out. You can save your money on the Nasdaq or the S&P. If any of those were ways that you thought, I can see why you think them because it's logical. But again, this isn't meant to be logical in the sake of thinking with your emotions, right? Because you're just following your plan with each market. Each market is separate. The Dow, while it was a stop out, where we breached the conservative volatility box, that's when the Nasdaq was still giving us our entry, right? We had just barely started to graze the tip of the volatility box entry line, and so it's important to just keep the two, keep each market separate in your head, and don't let this sort of bias trickle down into your trading, because I think sometimes it saves you, but more times than not, it probably hurts you. And then you see this trade actually pan out, two trades at least in the S&P and the Nasdaq that would have helped you end the day positive, but instead you say might just have your losses on the Dow. So that's just something to keep in mind, an observation. Once again, you had your end of hour entry. This gave you your fill, and then the MOC data told us to stay out of the markets, along with the fact that it was just towards the end of the day. All right, so once again, for today, we had a total of three trades that set up, total winning percentage of 66% for a total P&L of positive 225. Not a huge winning day, but a winning day nonetheless. We'll take it. I look forward to trading with you tomorrow. Again, beware of all of these events that we have coming up tomorrow. We laid out our game plan for all of our Volatility Box subscribers, and we wish you well trading tomorrow's events. All right, take care, trade smart, and we'll see you tomorrow in tomorrow's nightly recap video.